things over time, you see how it changed. So I would say that, so maybe what we should do in our cultural theory, right? It's always, now it's in our cultural theory, we are still using kind of born analog media, you know, which have certain limitations in terms of representation of complexity. So you see, it all comes, in my mind, and maybe I'm just wrong, right? In my mind, it all makes a full circle, right?
Yeah, these are 19th century neo-Kantian ideas of taxonomy.
Yeah.
And you need to advance into assemblage.
Assemblage
where we're exploring the possibilities and potentials of collision between different mediums.
But there's a political reason why financial things are often excluded or inferior.
No.
Include scientific.
Exactly.
There's a question of pedigree.
No, I completely agree, but I also want to say that, again, you know, it was made very clear to me because I spent 3 days in Prague. And Prague turns out to be architecture to be extremely rich, mm-hmm. because in the second part of 19th, and maybe until Hitler, not Hitler, Hitler, until Hitler, you know, was actually one of the richest cities in Europe. So you go over, and everybody thinks about the Prague as, okay, here is the square of medieval cathedrals. But it has you know, amazing richness of this kind of species, right, of buildings. And you find this, you know, buildings which were done by the architects who kind of famous for a time, you know, but they're kind of not on the kind of map because we don't belong to any easy describable style. Mm-hmm. So I don't think, I mean, I completely agree with you about this politics of exclusion that has to do with, let's say, well, the kind of vernacular versus professional and our so-called reasons. But I don't think it's the only. I don't think the social reasons are the only reasons, right? It's also the reasons of kind of the limitations of using analog media to present and narrate culture. Okay. I think, but you know, it's a hypothesis, right?
You're going forth here. We'll link to a kind of a, as I just mentioned, a kind of breakdown in the concept of culture, or a kind of dissolving of the concept of human culture, so that it will then spread out into all human activities, so for example, science or medicine or others, which are also culture in some way. But you know that this genetic, especially in terms of a software model of using techniques as DNA, I think you'll end up incorporating all human activities in your definition of culture.
Well. Yes, but you know, I also know how to do a boundary, right? If I want to, right? No, you're absolutely right, and but let's just say for a purpose of argument, but also for a purpose of be able to deal with practically, right? Let's say, let's say we limit ourselves to like what we traditionally think of cultural artifacts, right?
But the positive thing is that you can make a traversal of human artifacts, which come from various practices, and instead of having like your guidebook having just the Art Deco buildings of Paris,
right,
you'll have some kind of Art Deco
a different slice. Yeah, and of course you can look at Art Deco across different media, right?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah, but it can be a whole different visualization, right?
Yeah. I don't know if people are ready for that, but.
Well, I think sometimes you see like in, you know, university classes or in, you know, exhibitions,
yeah,
right? People would say, okay, let's make an exhibition about various between the wars, right? Or you know, Art Deco. I mean, in some cases, people are very ready to look at this kind of horizontal slices, but again, it's a slice which is under the name of particular categories, you know. So. But we have people who are from curating world and art world, so now we kind of. You know, I kind of also did this a little bit because maybe I felt maybe sometimes spending too much time in software. So now we kind of moved into the realm of, let's say, culture in general, all the way we kind of right represent, historicize, narrate, exhibit it. So what do you guys think about this?
I have a few comments.
I was referring myself to this part. You know what? We guys are completely dominating, so let's see if we try to get them to speak a little bit.
Can I sit over there?
How about we skip one and the next one? Okay, no, but what do you guys think?
As far as curating is concerned, it is happening, it has been happening
fairly recently, I don't know if you were taking MoMA as an example, MoMA, it took a really long time for MoMA to cross those borders, and actually the remodeling of the building forced them to, when they had to close the photography gallery, they suddenly had no other place to exhibit the photographies
right.
than inside the other collection, and that was sort of the first, I'm not talking about temporary exhibitions where they have been mixing media mm-hmm. before, but in terms of the permanent
mm-hmm.
collection,
yeah.
it was the first time that they actually mixed the media in a way. Surprisingly, there's a lot of, the Tate Modern in London is hanged according to this principle. I mean, it's all mixed up.
I think the Tate Modern opened. I think we kind of broke away from media category, and it was like a whole floor about like the figure or the landscape. But now, the last time I was there, we went back to all the isms along.
But yeah, because what I was going to say, one thing is they moved from one type of category to another type of category.
Yeah.
So they didn't
yeah.
really go
that's
that
right.
crazy.
That's right. You go from four to
because,
level four.
And the other thing is the main criticism is that you lose this sense of pedagogic or didactic. So they lose their, the audience. I don't know if the audience is not prepared, but the institution is not prepared to challenge the audience
mm-hmm.
that much. So people still want to go to a museum because they want to be educated, and then they know that, after constructivism or after futurism, constructivism, they need to have this sort of chronological
narrative.
Well, they need a narrative,
whatever it is.
Yeah. And when they don't find it, they get challenged, which...
Did you see the last documenta, where they mixed the all kinds of stuff together?
Yeah.
It was quite successful, I thought.
Yeah, but you're out
but
of
the documenta
is
designed for different kind of audience, right?
Yeah.
It's really for art professionals, opposed to for the general museum.
No, but
also
people
right?
really
you're
didn't like it. People really trashed it.
It's another type of institution.
Sure. Yeah, but it may become the.
Yeah.
It may be a kind
I
of.
I think it will, but the time lag is huge.
Yeah. Well, again, I just want to say that. It's also very interesting because to a certain extent, right, we have philosophy, we have our history, we follow all those disciplines, but we use these representational systems, physical language and writing, which are very, very old. And then the development of modern science, right, which is, right, is basically enabled by the other representational semiotic systems, such as mathematics, such as visualization, and when I mean visualization, I don't mean start to excel, I'm talking about Cartesian space, right? Where you can represent kind of function in a three-dimensional space as sort of a form of visualization. Yeah, and then of course you have Mendeleev, right, and the periodic system, which has 100 elements, and you have contemporary biology. So I mean, if scientists would only write texts, right, and wouldn't use mathematics, wouldn't use computers, wouldn't use graphs, you wouldn't have contemporary science. So in other words, I think that if we want to have lots of categories, if we want to be able to visualize temporal changes or historical changes or dynamics, that's why guys are kind of pushing for visualization, because it's kind of very difficult to do it in language, right? Please.
I just want to point out, in neuroscience right now, there's a guy named Olaf Sporn, and they're doing graph theory,
mm-hmm.
which is how the structure of your brain affects the functionality, and the functionality affects the structure. And they have, it's a system that's very similar to this about how there's how, it's not a completely random network, but it's also not a matrix, about how these,
mm-hmm.
in this graph theory, they call it small worldness.
Yes.
In each network.
Yeah, well,
and this is just.
The network theory, small
network,
worlds and,
And scale-free networks, and this is really, right in that same vein.
Well, I think it's actually kind of much more simplified. My stuff is much more simplified because, but it's definitely it's connected, right? I mean, you can think of it as a graph. I was thinking about more like a sled, every species has, right, certain DNAs, right? And then the DNAs are kind of shared. So I wasn't thinking about the graph, but if you think about more like evolution, then I think the graph theory or network theory would also be very applicable, right? I mean, anything just to move us beyond, five categories would make me happy, right?
I think you could extrapolate beyond the DNA, though. I think the idea of having a DNA of a work of art is that DNA is going